again, everyone. It's good to have you back with us again. We've made it through another week. And you know, I've been watching the news and hearing lots of talk, but you know what? I've seen a lot of blessings in the course of this week. I've heard a lot of testimonies. I've read a lot of posts on Facebook. I have read your emails that you have submitted. I have heard the cries of multitudes bemoaning the fact of being stuck at home. But you know what? This gives us a great opportunity to focus our attention, doesn't it? Now today is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday. We consider the events of today in history, and we realize that the world has been looking for a savior. The world has been looking for an answer. They've longed for the day that one would come and would be the answer to their prayers, the answer to the prophecy. They were in the process of seeing something wonderful unfold before their eyes. So I want us to look for a moment at Luke chapter 19, verses 41 through 42. Just a moment. But I'd like for us to pray before we begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your wonderful touch, your miraculous care, the fact that you watch over us. Lord, we know, and you know, that we are living in dangerous days. There seems to be peril at every turn. There seems to be threats of illness. There seems to be a cloud of gloom hanging over society. And yet, Lord, we have been given an opportunity to pause. We are encouraged to remain in our homes. Our churches may not be full of people, but the church has gone out into the world, and they are ministering to needs over the phone, on front porches, cards, letters, email, text messages. Lord, we thank you for the new and exciting ways that we are learning to communicate when we cannot be face to face. Lord, we ask that you would touch us today as we consider this passage. Help us to see the deeper meanings. You know our hearts. You know the folks that are in need of prayer and those, Lord, that are struggling on. They have things hidden away in their hearts. So, Lord, as we focus upon this passage, help our cares and our worries to melt away. Help us to find a peace that is beyond ourselves, a peace that we can only find in you. We ask, O God, that our hearts would be open, our ears would be in tune to what you have in store for us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, we consider the life of Christ and we consider his ministry, his earthly ministry here. And we have heard him say that he didn't want anyone to know that he was the Messiah. He asked them to be quiet. And we find that up to this time, Jesus had not sought openly to be called the Messiah. But now he allowed it and even encouraged it. Everything that he did over the course of these days was designed to call attention to the fact that he is the Messiah. As we consider the events of this period of time that we call Holy Week, We are given a beautiful tapestry that points directly to a Savior. The longing of the world and the problem of dominating sin finds its answer. I want to consider the events as they unfold in the course of this week, and to realize that everything that is about to happen in those days pointed to a Savior. We know the story of the triumphal entry. We know that Jesus told his disciples to go into the town ahead, and that they would find a colt tied, and told the owner, "The master has need of it." And the master, the owner of that donkey, recognized those words. Surely God had been speaking to his heart. But there's more to the story, because the prophecy said that one would come riding on a colt. The prophecy is fulfilled, bringing the hope of a deliverer. The people would recognize what they saw. The people were laying palm branches down at his feet, laying their coats down at his feet. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And, of course, there were those that complained, and Jesus said, "You know, the rocks will cry out if these are made to be silent." But as Jesus approached Jerusalem, this passage records that when he saw the city, he began to weep. We know that the heart of God was breaking at the lostness of the world. Countless theologians have speculated on the reason for his tears. Jesus also wept when he came to the tomb of Lazarus. Why would Jesus weep? His heart was breaking and burdened over the needs, not just of Jerusalem, but of the world. You see, humanity needed a place to meet God, and they found that place in Jesus. But Jesus would weep. A domineering God would really be untouched by the world's suffering. He simply wouldn't care if he was a domineering God. But our God is a loving God and a Savior would weep for the needs of the people. But then we find that there's the story of the cleansing of the temple. Jesus went into the temple area and he saw money changers buying and selling in the temple court. Jesus overturned the tables and drove them out, told them that "My Father's house is a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves, a place of bargaining, almost like a marketplace." True worship had become an opportunity for scandal, you see. Scandal, where people would come and was able to get their sacrifices their animals for the sacrifice. It became an overpricing and a burdensome thing placed upon the people. But as I've already stated, humanity needed a place to meet God and hear His word. They did not need another marketplace. What they needed was a place that they could come and pray and hear the word of God read. That was the place that they wanted. That was the place that they needed. But corruption had actually entered into the house of God. Then as we move on, we find that we have the account of the Last Supper. Jesus gets a room, an upper room, to have the Passover with his disciples. And again, his disciples went ahead, secured the room, and prepared. And Jesus washed the disciples' feet, became a servant in their midst. It was a demonstration of the meaning of sacrifice and servanthood. It was a sobering time for the disciples. They saw their master gird himself with a towel and to kneel before them and wash their feet. Jesus took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to the disciples. And he said, "Take, eat of this. This is my body, which is broken for you." And he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. I want you to drink it, all of you. Remember me, that my blood was shed for your sin." And of course, we have the account of one who would betray. Jesus knew that Judas would be the one. Judas left the place and went out into the night. Following this supper, we find that Jesus took time to go to the garden to pray. And he shares his time with the disciples. The intercession to God on our behalf, you see. His will was secondary to the will of the Father. He prayed that if this cup could pass from him, "Please, Father, if there's any other way, and yet not my will, but your will would be done," he said. You see, his will was secondary to the will of the Father. And the prayer that he prayed, he said, "I pray for these that you have given me. I pray for them. Keep them from the evil in the world. You have given them to me. I ask that you would keep them." And then he prayed, "Father, I not only pray for them, but I pray for those who will come to know me by their word." That would be us. Jesus prayed for us in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was facing his own death. His thoughts and his heart was on those there and those who would come and those who had been. His focus was on the world and what was about to be accomplished. But there would be the demonstration of Christ's priestly role as intercessor. He would be the high priest to make intercession for the Father on our behalf. As we have studied in the weeks past, the lesson of the tabernacle and the ministry of the high priest, Jesus now is taking on that role. The sacrifices would be ended because the greatest sacrifice of all would be given to pay the price for our sin once and for all. Such hope was there. Such a demonstration of the fulfillment of prophecy that was declared from the moment sin entered into the world in the Garden of Eden, the result of humanity's disobedience and separation from the direct fellowship with God. The story does not end here in victory. I am always torn on Palm Sunday. My heart is torn from one side to the other because I think of the triumphal entry. I think of all of the praise and all of the example that Jesus gave and all that this triumphal entry meant into the lives of people. You see, our lives need to have a triumphal entry of Christ. Our lives need to understand the importance of Jesus weeping over our condition, praying for us, giving us the example of communion, the sacraments, all that was done for us. We could stop right here and be filled with praise and admiration. But there's more to the story. And here is the heart-rending side. The crucifixion and the burial of the Son of God. The beating of the guiltless, the mockery of the innocent, the death of one who promised life, and the burial in a borrowed tomb. All that would happen that day. Crucify him. Crucify him, he shouted. The crowd. Crucify him. Give us Barabbas, a thief. And they took him out and they beat him and they mocked him. Said that he was barely recognizable from the beating that he took. Had to carry his own cross. Became so weak that one along the street had to help him carry his cross at the demand of the Roman guard. Walking to Golgotha's hill, hearing the ring of the hammer against the nail as it pierced his hands and his feet. He would be raised between heaven and earth and mocked, made fun of. But then he would give up the spirit. It is finished, he cried. It is finished because he had completed everything that was prophesied about him. everything was fulfilled. It is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up the spirit. Sky became dark. Earthquake. Says that the veil in the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. Access was now made to the most holy place. We can approach God because our high priest tore the veil. He was taken down from the cross and placed in a borrowed tomb. I've always found it interesting that the tomb would be one that would be borrowed. You see, Jesus didn't need a permanent tomb. He only needed to borrow it for 3 days. Given by Joseph, his body would be wrapped so gently and so carefully, and placed in the tomb, and a stone would be rolled across the door, as if a stone could hold him. A seal was placed on that stone, and guards were placed at the opening, because they feared that the disciples may come and steal the body away. Now, after all of the indications and the demonstrations that point to a Savior, there is still one problem that remains. Death's hold on the soul of humanity. It appears that evil has triumphed, that sin has won the day. Jesus now lies in a tomb, and all hope is lost. If sin's debt had been paid and we are reconciled to God, what about commuting the sentence of death? Where's the hope? Where's the glory? Where is there life? This is not the end of the story. We're going to pick up this story next week. But for today, we sense the despair and the disappointment following on the heels of such a promise. The Lamb of God that came to take away the sin of the world paid the price. And we find that opportunity is knocking at the door. Join with me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, our hearts ache, and at the same time we are jubilant. The people in those days would have felt despair and disappointment, pain and loss. The disciples would be scattered. The followers would be hiding, for they thought hope was gone. But we know the rest of the story. We know what is going to happen. And so our hearts rejoice at the gift that was given, but our hearts are broken, because it was our sin that made Jesus' death necessary. It was our sin that nailed him to that cross. It was humanity's disobedience that sentenced him to death. It was our sin that cried out his death, just as surely as the crowds did on that day. We are ashamed of our sin. We are ashamed at our lack of commitment. But we are thankful for hope. We are thankful for your grace. We are thankful for your forgiveness. And we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for us. The Lamb of God that took away the sin of the world. Touch us, O God. Keep us close to the cross. Keep us in tune with you. And may we be the disciples that stand firm and wait for your orders to go forth. Give us strength for our days. Put protection around us in these days. The world needs deliverance. The world needs a healing of its sin and of disease and pain and death. We pray for your intercession. We've asked that you would work a miracle in our midst, and may people see the hand of God. May we be able to tell them of the hope of this week and all that next week holds in store. May we be able to tell the story. And may we be able to have a smile on our face that would be a cheerful uplift to those we come in contact with. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you now to just listen for a few moments at an amazing song that tells an amazing story. God bless you. And God go with you.
Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. Now when we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. First one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. So badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You! Him." Then his hand reached for his sword, and so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet upon the cross, I heard him pray, "Father, forgive them." Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I've lost all sense of time, until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, "Father, please forgive us, the lamb ran away." Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.